Hey guys, this is Dr. Sangeeta and welcome back to another lecture of Dental Pathshala. And today's video, we are going to talk about basically it is a part of the management of fracture. So what happens when a fracture patient comes to you? When a fracture patient comes to you, the first thing you are going to do is ABC. So maintain the airway, maintain the breathing, maintain the circulation. And once you do finishing that, once you do finishing maintaining airway, breathing and circulation, sometime you know it requires taking the patient to the operation theater, because sometimes you need to do the tracheostomy or either doing the nasotracheal intubation. So whatever surgical procedure you are doing, when you are taking the patient to the operation theater, along with that you are going. There is no use, I know you don't know doing tracheostomy, but being a maxillofacial surgeon, you are going to do the reduction of the fracture segment. So reduction of the fracture segment is basically taking the two fracture parts together. So that is known as the reduction. We have already covered the closed reduction, open reduction. Closed reduction is wherein we are not doing any surgery, we are just taking the fracture fragments together. Open reduction is when we are doing the surgery and taking the fragments back together. So you are doing the fix, you are doing the reduction as well as you are doing the intermaxillary fixation. Now what happens? Because of the face, see, face has got so many muscles, so many active muscles. So because of the pull from the muscles, there is going to be the displacement of the mobile section. So suppose if this is a mobile section, now what happens if this part is fractured? Because of the pull from the pterygoid muscles, this will be a backward pulling. So if you try to take it back, it is again going to back into the same previous position. So to in order to stop that, the first approach is, first, your first approach being an oral maxillofacial surgeon is that you are getting the teeth in occlusion. So once you are getting the teeth in the occlusion, so the automatically half of your job is done. Automatically the fracture segment, the original position of the fracture segment is back into its place. And you are going to fix the maxillary teeth to the mandibular teeth so that there is no movement of the fracture segment. So that the fracture segment is not moving. So you are fixing the maxillary teeth to the mandibular teeth. And this is your first line of treatment for the fracture. So before you are putting any plates, before you are putting any screws, so the first thing you are going to do is doing the reduction as well as the intermaxillary fixation. Intermaxillary fixation, or you can see the maxillomandibular fixation. So both are the same, one and the same thing. So intermaxillary fixation, we are going to fix the maxillary teeth to the mandibular teeth. You are taking the patient's relation into the centric relation. Now again, centric relation is the most physiological rest position wherein the maxilla is supposed to sit on the mandible. So centric relation we have already covered. So basically you are getting the teeth into the centric occlusion, centric relation, and then you are fixing the teeth, fixing the maxilla to the mandible. And today's video we are going to talk about the intermaxillary fixation in detail. So without further ado, let's get started. And before we get started, make sure you subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon. That way you get a notification as soon as I release a video lecture. So today's topic is the intermaxillary fixation. When do you do it? When are you doing the closed reduction? So when you are approximating the two fracture segments back into its place and you are just putting like a plaster, like how we do in the limbs. Like that, if you are putting like a plaster, either it can be a plaster cap, if you are doing external fixation also. So that case where you are placing the maxillary teeth to the mandibular teeth together and you are fixing these teeth. So basically this is a kind of an arch bar. So like that you are fixing these maxilla to the mandibular teeth together. So you are putting some wire, in that you are putting the maxillary teeth to the mandibular teeth together back into its place so that neither the maxilla is moving nor the mandible is moving. So that is used to do if you want to heal the fracture segment by the secondary healing. So secondary healing that we have covered in the open and closed reduction. So closed reduction wherein we are just approximating. So we are letting this bone heal with the help of the secondary healing, that is with the secondary union, that is the normal process of the healing. You are not fixing, you are not putting the plates, you are doing it normally. So in order to do that, you have to make sure that
this is fixed. The maxilla mandible or the fractured segment is fixed. The fractured segment is not displacing from its place. So this is the reason you are fixing the maxillary teeth to the mandibular teeth with the help of wire is known as the intermaxillary fixation. So it is basically a technique which is used to fix the fractured segments, to fix the maxilla to the mandible. And by reducing to its position by means of wire which are placed all around the teeth, which we call the interdental wiring. So basically this is the internal fixation. So the question which comes to my mind is that how do the patient eat when the jaws are wired shut? Then we have to do the Ryle's tube. Then the patient is on the Ryle's tube and patient is basically on the liquid diet. So if a closed fixation is done, then the patient is, because for closed reduction, the intermaxillary fixation is going to be 4 to 6 weeks of time. That is almost around a 1 month time. So almost around this period of time, all the teeth are shut. The jaw is wired shut. So either the patient is going to eat from the Ryle's tube, basically drink, we can say, because the patient is going to be on the liquid diet, or we can put a straw from the side and patient can have the liquid food from the side straw. So basically this intermaxillary fixation is done whenever there is a closed reduction. So we are talking about in here when the display. See, if you are trying to study the intermaxillary fixation, I recommend you to read first the difference between the closed and the open reduction, because then you will understand it better. Because in a closed reduction, where we are approximating the fracture segment, in that case we are doing the intermaxillary fixation for a long period of time. In case we are putting a mini plate or we are putting the screws, in that case IMF is done only before the surgery, while we are putting the plate. So 7 to 10 days is a time wherein we are keeping the patient on the rest so that the edema subside, and after that we are putting the plates, which is the internal fixation. So before that only, if we are doing internal fixation, only 7 to 10 days of time the patient is going to be on the intermaxillary fixation. Once the plate is done, once we have done the open reduction, then the intermaxillary fixation, the wires between the maxillary and mandibular teeth are opened up, because already we have put plate and plate can stabilize it. So this is the reason we are doing. And now intermaxillary fixation is done when there is a known displaced fracture. So wherein there is a known displaced fracture, that means fracture segments are not moving from its position. So in that case, you are doing a closed reduction. So all of the indication of closed reduction are going to be the indications for the intermaxillary fixation. Also in case of a grossly comminuted fracture, because the fracture, grossly comminuted fracture means the fracture bone is basically broken into small little pieces. So in that case, you cannot do the plates, right? So you cannot do the internal fixation. In that case, you are going to do the closed reduction, or I can say you are going to do the internal intermaxillary fixation. Also the fracture in the children, because they have tooth buds, so we don't want to damage the tooth buds. Or in case of edentulous atrophic maxilla, where there is no bone, where we cannot do the internal fixation because there is no bone. So coming to the contraindication, if the patient is having any history of seizures. So if the patient is having history of seizures, we cannot do intermaxillary fixation because we are shunting the maxillary as well as the mandibular teeth. So we are wiring these teeth together so that these teeth are not moving. Any compromised pulmonary function, because we don't want patient to have difficulty in breathing, and also gastrointestinal disorder, because the patient won't be able to eat properly. So if the patient is having any gastrointestinal disorder, that also we try to avoid the intermaxillary fixation for a long period of time. So the basic methods of intermaxillary fixation are, the first one is the direct interdental wiring. Direct interdental wiring is wherein we are doing the direct wiring. So let me just show you how do we do all these procedures. So suppose this is the teeth. So direct interdental wiring is, we are putting the wire all around the teeth and we are just twisting it. We are twisting it like this. So like that we are doing for maxilla, and the same way we are doing for the mandible, and both these wires we are again twisting it together. So that way we are fixing the maxillary to the mandibular teeth like that. So suppose this is the mandibular teeth, suppose this is the maxillary teeth. So also one more wire is placed, this is the direct wiring, right? So direct wiring for maxilla, direct wiring for mandible get into occlusion and then they are fixed like this. So the maxilla as well as the maxillary mandibular is fixed. So this is the direct interdental wiring. Now coming to the indirect interdental wiring, so the IV loop. How do we make this IV loop? First of all we make the eyelet. So like that we make the eyelet. After that we make the eyelet. Now in between the two teeth we pass this eyelet, and this is the buccal. So in between the two teeth we are going to pass the eyelet and get these parts, and one end of this wire we are going to put in this eyelet. So we are going to put within this eyelet and we are just fixing it. So like that there is going to be, and then twisting it. So like that there is going to be the twisting. So this is the indirect interdental wiring. Then we have continuous or multiple loop wiring. So continuous or multiple loop wiring is, it is kind of a continuous wiring. So it is like one loop is there, then like that, and then continuous is when you are making a continuous. So like this, then again out of this wire you are making one more loop. So like that multiple loops are there, multiple eyelets are there. So this is the continuous or multiple wiring. Arch bars are a kind of bars. Okay, so these are a kind of bars which are put on the, so these are a kind of bars. Maxillary, they are facing upward. Mandibular, they are facing downward. Either you can put the elastic screws, okay, or else you can put the wires, the ligature wire. So like that you are putting the wire. So they are a kind of bars basically. So they are kind of a bars. So you are putting on the labial side of the teeth. So like that these are the arch bars. Cap splints are used in the children. Gunning splints are used in the denture patients. So edentulous patient, we use gunning splints. And pin fixation, wherein we are fixing the fracture segments with the help of the pins. And we have some common rules for wiring. So the rules of wiring is, first of all, the wire is pre-stretched. We don't want that the wire to be loose, we want it to be fixed. So we pre-stretch it, we stretch it before using it. So this is the first rule, that we pre-stretch the wire before using it. So any work hardened wire, so basically work hardened wire is a kind of soft wire which is through the hardness process which is hardened. So while placing the wires on the lingual surface, we make sure that we are passing below the cingulum area. So if suppose this is the tooth surface, so we are, while taking from the lingual side, we are taking it below the cingulum area. So suppose like this, if we are taking this wire, so like this, if we are taking this wire, so we are going below the cingulum region, not above the cingulum, below the cingulum region. So this is also one of the principles of wiring. And then while twisting the wire, this is very important. While we are twisting the wire, suppose this is the tooth, and while you are twisting the wire, the twisting, it is supposed to be in the, always in the clockwise rotation. It is never going to be in the anti-clockwise. If you are doing the anti-clockwise rotation, it will open up. So in order to do this, you have to do the, I'm sorry for this, you have to do the clockwise rotation. And after tightening these wire, you have to make sure that the ends are cut, because otherwise these ends are going to impinge the soft tissue, impinge the labial mucosa, oral mucosa, and they are going to hurt the gingiva also to the patient. So we have to make sure that after we are done with the tightened, so we have to make sure the ends are cut short and they are tucked towards the teeth inside the gingiva. So while you are doing this, these ends are basically, so these ends are basically tucked into the gingiva. So these, this is outer, little bit outer. So this is like this, tucked inside the gingiva. This is the eyelet loop. So these are tucked inside the gingiva so that they are not hurting.
So guys, this is a demonstration of direct interdental wiring, Gilmer's approach. So a 15 centimeter wire is taken and it's pre-stretched. We are not stretching it right now for the demo purpose. So it is passed through the interdental space. Now this 15 centimeter wire of 0.35 millimeter diameter stainless steel wire is passed around the teeth interdental spaces. And this wire is twisted. So around the neck of the two ends, around the neck of the tooth, this wire is twisted in the clockwise rotation. So this is rotated in the clockwise rotation and it produces a tail of 3 centimeters. Now this tail is in the end, it is cut off in order to avoid the soft tissue injury. So all these ends, basically the ends which are now we have, these are fixed. So this end which is left now is fixed with the maxillary. So like that, there is a fixation of maxilla to the mandible. So this end is basically fixed to the maxillary teeth. So like that, in the other teeth region also, like that, these wires are made. So these wire, interdental wire, are made in the other tooth region and they are fixed to each other with this tail. So guys, this is the demonstration of the IV loop method wire, in that we are taking a wire and this wire is stretched first, which I'm not giving you the demo. So first thing we are doing is taking a wire and making the eyelet. So we are making the eyelet by twisting the wire in the middle of the length and with the equal shafts. Now we are giving 3 to 4 turns, and 3 to 4 turns are enough, and these ends of the eyelet wire are cut off obliquely to equalize their length so as to produce a sharp point which will readily pass through the interdental spaces. So we are passing it through the interdental spaces, and both the ends are passed through the interdental spaces, and basically the distal end now these ends are passing through the interdental spaces, and the distal end is basically passed through the eyelet which is passed beneath the mesial shaft. So this is passing. Basically the shaft of the eyelet are curved parallel and both the ends are passed through the respective interdental spaces. So in the respective teeth of the interdental spaces, and then the distal end is passed through the eyelet and it is passed beneath the mesial shaft. So it is passed beneath the mesial shaft. And now it is twisted in the clockwise direction. This method was given by Robert H. Ivey in USA, and this is the reason it is known as Ivey method. Now this is twisted in the clockwise direction. Of course, it is always twisted in clockwise direction, and twisted ends are cut short and they are formed into the loops which are tucked in the interdental spaces. So guys, this is the demonstration of the clove hitch. So first we are making an eyelet. If you remember, in the eyelet also, eyelet wire, IV eyelet wiring, we have done the same thing. We have made the eyelet. Now the difference is one end is smaller. We have kept one end smaller and one end larger. So one shaft is smaller for this and one shaft is larger for this. And this clove hitch actually is a modification, and it is used when only few teeth are present. Basically when only few teeth are absent, or you can say few teeth are present. Basically in case of a missing teeth, we are going to use this clove hitch. So rotation is always going to be the clockwise rotation. If you are doing this wiring thing, so every rotation is going to be the clockwise. If you are loosening it, then it is a anti-clockwise. So always remember that rotation is always going to be a clockwise rotation. Now the eyelet, once you made the eyelet, so we are doing the clockwise rotation, making the eyelet. And now once we have made this eyelet, as you can see, this is the eyelet. Now one end is the shorter, as you can see, one shaft is the longer shaft. So we are going to place it on the teeth now. So this is the missing teeth. So we are using it this around the missing teeth. So we are keeping it, and one shaft we are revolving. So around the teeth we are revolving the another one shaft, which is the bigger shaft. So one shaft of the eyelet is formed into a hitch, other end is rotated. and we are joining both of these parts. So these shafts are joining and again we are rotating in a clockwise direction. Now there is also a tie which is a side of this. This tie wire is basically passed through the eyelet. So the tie wire basically which is attached to the maxilla to the mandible. So the wire which is going to attach all of the components. So this is why this wire is made from the eyelet. Now as you can see the side there is one eyelet and another one is when we have joined both of these shafts. So basically we have two shafts and maybe we have to make sure that we are not impinging. So this is the eyelet. As you can see this is the eyelet and we are passing the tie wire from through this eyelet.
Talking about arch bar, arch bar are in arch and this is a kind of a bar. So it is not made up of plastic, of course it is made up of metal. So it is bar like this which has ends. So in the mandible the ends are facing downward. So because its shape is like this, so we are taking right now like this. So suppose these are the two mandibular teeth. So this bar is going to be at the apex and this bar is going to be, if you can see now, this bar is going to be like this and we want to secure this bar. How do we secure this bar now? First of all, we have to take a wire. We have to place it interdentally between the teeth and we have to put this bar inside the wire and we have to pull it like this. Now, what do we do? Now we have two ends here. Both the ends we are again taking it interdentally. But one end we are taking beneath this wire. So one end we are taking beneath the wire. Other end we are taking above this wire. Above this bar. Sorry. One end we are taking beneath the bar. Other we are taking above the bar. And we are twisting it. And once we start twisting it clockwise now. You see what happens. So we are twisting it, twisting it, twisting it. And once we are done twisting this wire. This arch bar is going to be secured with the teeth. So this is how this arch bar is secured to the teeth. And then because this arch bar has, so this arch bar, if we take the side section, so we are taking this side section like this. So we are taking the side section of the arch bar. So it is going to be like this for the maxillary. For the mandibular arch bar, it is going to be like this. So that we can engage the elastics. So the maxillary teeth is, if we take the side profile, this, the mandibular teeth is this. Once we have secured this arch bar with the teeth, then we secure the, then we do the intermaxillary fixation. Either we are using elastics or we are using the ligation wire. So like that we are securing this arch bar also. So there are many kind of arch bars which are prefabricated. Now these bars, they come in the market. These bars, they are many bars. They are, these are like Jelenco bars. Also the Erich arch bar, which is the most popular and the most famous bar. Also Hamilton is also a kind of arch bar. So like that we have some arch bar because these are in arch shape and these are bars. This, that is why they are known as the arch bar. So these are basically the prefabricated bars. So like that if you look at, they will be like this. So this is a arch bar and we have to place it at the apex of the teeth. So these bars are basically effective. You don't have to do this wiring because this wiring is a hectic process. Now if you look at the direct interdental wiring. So what happens if one of the wire in the direct interdental wiring breaks? Then we have to release all the wires and everything is to be done again. What happens in the indirect interdental wiring? It is a very hectic procedure. So these arch bars are basically very quick, inexpensive method of fixation as well as these are the effective method. Then why? When do you use these arch bars? So when there are insufficient teeth which are not allowing the eyelet wiring because eyelet wiring require teeth. So when they are not sufficient teeth, then we can use these arch bars. Also, in any simple dentoalveolar fracture, where the multiple teeth bearing area, tooth bearing fragments in the jaw require reduction into the arch form. So if we require reduction into the arch form, then because these arch bar are making the arch shape also, so we can use these and also as an integral part of the internal skeletal suspension in treatment of the middle facial third, basically the leaf wood fracture. So these bars are available in very forms. So bar, they can be, they should be cut accurately to the length of the arch. So if the arch is short, then small size arch bars, big, then big size arch bar. So these bars, and they should be cut accurately to the length of the arch. And these accuracy in this regard will be prevent any injury to the adjacent soft tissue. Because if any ends are protruding, then they are going to impinge the soft tissue and there is going to be the trauma to the soft tissue. So each arch bar is to be fixed individually, one to the upper and then one to the lower. On the upper jaw, the hooks are arranged in the upward direction. So if you look at in the upper jaw, the hooks are arranged in the upward direction. In the lower jaw, the hooks are arranged in the downward direction. And this is in order to make sure the adaptation of either the elastics or the ligation wire. So these arch bars should be adapted to the buccal surfaces in the each arch, and basically towards the apex. So these arch bar, see, this is not a correct diagram. So if you look at, these arch bar are to be placed at the apex area, so near the apices of the tooth. So these arch bar are to be placed here like this at the apex of the tooth. So any bending of the arch should start at the buccal side from the last tooth, so progressing toward the middle and finishing towards the other end. So how do we start placing, how do we start securing this wire? From one end, then we start securing it, and we go to the other end. So this is how we secure it. So arch bar is fixed to individual. These are fixed to molars. First of all, posterior teeth, these are fixed to the molars, and then in the front teeth, it is also one of secured, and then again to the molars. So basically, these end of the wires is above the bar and end of the wire is below the bar while we are securing it and twisting into the clockwise direction. So this is how we secure these arch bars. Basically, these arch bars are very advantageous because they include less trauma, and also they're not hectic. They're very simple to use. So in case of any displaced fracture, if we can say the body fracture, so the arch bar, it can divide the body fracture and it can get into its place on the either side of the fracture line. So these are very effective. These are very simple to use. And when wiring of the teeth will not provide adequate fixation, then we go for the splints. So splints are basically the horizontal splinting is done when the fracture line is required, when the fracture zone is required without closing the patient mouth. So when the both jaws are edentulous, that case we use splints, or in case of a growing children where there is a mixed dentition period and we don't want to damage any tooth germ. So basically these cast metal splints we have. We make these custom splints. So cast metal splints to individual tooth. To individual person. So these cast metal spring are fabricated. Basically, first of all, we take the impression of the patient. After we take the impression of the patient, if suppose wherever the fracture line is, we fracture the same cast with the help of a saw. Now, if you have seen a saw like this. Saw is there, no? Cutting. So we cut the cast with the help of the saw and we make the fracture line in the cast only. And then after that we make the cast, we reassemble the cast. So we articulate the cast in the occlusion. We reassemble the cast along with the fracture line. And we basically pour the base of the cast and then we splint it. We make the splint. So after that we articulate the cast in the occlusion, proper occlusion. We make a splint from the articulation. So we make this splint with the help of a wax sheet. So after we make the splint with the help of the wax sheet in the centric occlusion, in the centric relation. So this wax sheet is, first of all, it is checked in the patient mouth. And then this wax sheet, so basically up till the gingival margin, we make this splint. And after that we check this in the patient's mouth. After that, we do the wax trine procedure. So after the trine procedure is done, when we send it to the lab, and once we send it to the lab, the lab gives us the metal analog of this. So give us the metal splint, which is used in the patient as a splint. Also, we can make the acrylic splints. So splint can be made from acrylic also. We have two kind of splints in acrylic. One is the gunning splint, in which even the denture can also be used. So gunning splint is basically used in the edentulous, in the complete denture patients. Also, some another kind of acrylic splint we have is the lateral compression splint. So lateral compression splint is basically used in the children. So lateral compression splint as well as the gunning splint. Now this lateral compression splint, it is used for stabilizing mainly the mandibular arch. So it is used in the children with a mixed dentition period, wherein we don't want to damage the developing tooth buds. So we are doing open reduction and direct fixation, where the open reduction and the direct fixation is contraindicated. We are using this lateral compression splints for the children. It can even though also be used in the adult mandibular fracture also, where the stability cannot be obtained by any other means, any other type of the horizontal wiring method. So we can use this lateral compression splint. Now gunning splint we use in the complete denture patient. We have already made a separate video. So there is another separate video on gunning splint. Basically these splints are used in the complete denture patients. So either you are making these gunning splints or you are using denture as gunning splint. So what happens in the gunning splint? You are putting a wire all around. So let me show you. So you are splinting the denture with the bone. So basically denture along with the wiring inside the bone. So this is how you are doing the circumferential wiring to fix the splint to the denture, to fix the splint either through the denture or to the acrylic splint. So basically you are wiring along the bone and you are fixing this denture or you are fixing the splint to the bone. And the anterior portion is left open so that the patient can eat. So canine to canine teeth are extracted either, or if you are making a new splint, then you are not putting anything in here. So two methods, per-alveolar and circumferential, that we have covered in the gunning splint video, and also I have shown with the help of a demonstration also to make it easier for you to understand the gunning splint. So the last one we have in today's lecture is the biphasic pin fixation. Now this biphasic pin fixation is basically the pin is fixed with the extra oral device. So there is a external fixation appliance. It can be either the Morris appliance or the Roger and Dresser appliance. So these extra oral, or we can say basically the external fixation appliance, are screwed on either side of the fracture. So basically there are pins. There are two pins which are joined, if you can see. Two pins are joined in the fracture and two pins are joined in the either side of the fracture line. And these pins are inserted into a transverse rod. So there is a transverse rod in which these pins are joined, and these pins are assembled with this rod held by the universal joints attached to the transversal bars. So these pins are 7 cm long and 3 cm wide. And this dimension is to make sure that there is no swelling and there is no edema, and they also provide strength. So these pins are constructed with the inert metal so that there is no bone infection, so that there is no local osteitis, and they're inserted into the bone using the hand power drills. So these pins are, the types of these pins are the Cluston Walker pin, the East Grinstead type pin, MacGregor pin, Molly pins, or the taller pins. So these are the pins which are used with the external fixation. So these screwed are placed. See, can you see these screws are placed on either side of the fracture line? So two screws are placed in the fracture as well as on the either side of the fracture line. But this procedure require a stab incision. So basically these holes are drills into the mandible. So this is a kind of an invasive procedure. So this procedure, if this need of this procedure basically eliminates the intermaxillary fixation, because we are going the extra oral appliance and hygiene can also be maintained. But nowadays, because of the modern antibiotics, because of the surgical methods which are nowadays used, so these pins are eliminated. We don't use the pin fixation method now because of the modern technology. So this is about the intermaxillary fixation, and I hope that you have enjoyed the video. I hope that you have enjoyed the session and learned something in this session. So if you like the video, give it a thumbs up. If you enjoy watching our channel, then share it with your friends. Subscribe to our channel to get more videos like this. And stay safe, and I'll see you soon.